Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. Today is February 12th. Today is the sixth Sunday after the Epiphany. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. We begin by preparing our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. So I'd ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of the red worship book in the pew. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. We're singing a very old hymn. The text was written by Bianco da Siena, who lived in 1434, very old, before the discovery of America in 1492. This hymn was written, Come Down, O Love Divine. Come Down, O Love Divine, written by Bianco da Siena, 1434.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Jackson will be doing the readings.
The first reading this morning is from Deuteronomy chapter 15. And Moses said to the people, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Demetroff.
Thank you.
Even now you are still not ready, for you are still flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh, and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos, and what is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants working together. You are God's field, God's building. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pastors, Pastor John Pollock.
According to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter, glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, so your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you, that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Just two quick announcements. Before I ask you to give your attention to the choir, that is, first of all, today, as many of you know, some of you may not realize that today is Bill Shively's 106th birthday. So if you haven't wished Bill a happy birthday, send him a card at Forest Glen or call him, please do so and congratulate him on his 106th. And the only other announcement is a reminder, Ash Wednesday is Wednesday, March 1st. Begins our Lent season. Easter is April 16th. Now would you please devote, give your attention to the choir. Thank you. And As the speaker is making his presentation, there are parts of it that you become excited about. You're thinking, wow, this guy's really got it together and really knows what's going on. But then, as he continues, there are parts that you're like, oh, I don't know about that. And then when it's done, and it's all over, and you and your friend are driving back home after the presentation, and he asks you what you thought about it, you tell your friend that although you found a lot of things interesting and thought-provoking, you just felt that the speaker was making demands on you that you just can't meet. And so you want to pass on becoming a disciple of the speaker because the demands you couldn't meet and what he was demanding. Well, in our gospel lesson today, Jesus continues with his confrontation with the Pharisees about the true meaning of the law. And to sum up what Jesus is saying is that the law gives us demands we can't meet. The law gives us demands we can't meet. So Jesus is speaking about the demands of God. God demands perfect righteousness. We read that last week in verse 20, when Jesus said, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." You have to be perfect if you're going to abide by the law. If you're going to meet the demands of God, you have to be perfect in the fulfilling of those demands. And that's a demand we just can't meet because we sin and fall short of the glory of God. Yet the Pharisees, they thought they could fulfill that demand of righteousness because they had a very narrow view on how to fulfill it. And this is why Jesus talks like he does in our gospel reading for this morning, because he is showing them how foolish they are by having such a narrow view of the law and by thinking that enables them to fulfill it. As Jesus says throughout this reading, he goes, "You have heard that it was said in days of old," or "You have heard that it was said to the ancient ones." Whatever that means, you have understood and you have performed what was spoken and commanded to you by the rabbis in the past. By putting it that way, Jesus is already alerting the crowd that they're wrong. The rabbis were wrong. The Pharisees were wrong. Because then Jesus uses the phrase, "But I say to you." In other words, now I am putting forth what is the truth. I am putting forth what you really have to know and need to know in order for salvation. And often, how often do we read in the Gospels where after Jesus is teaching, people in the crowd will look at one another and say, "Where does he get this from? He doesn't teach like any other teacher we ever heard before. He teaches with an authority they don't have." And of course he did, because he's the Son of God. He is the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Savior of the world. So of course he speaks with authority. And so what it boils down to as we read those verses is motivation. What is the motivation, first of all, behind the law? And what is the motivation that you have in trying to fulfill that law? The Pharisees would pray, they would fast, they would give alms, but they would do it for what they could get out of it. They did it for show. They did it to bring attention to themselves. They didn't do it because of having the love of God, which is supposed to be the true motivation. The Pharisees, as I said, looked at everything narrowly. First thing Jesus brings up is about murder. "You have heard that it was said of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother or sister will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother or sister will be liable to the council, and whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire." The Pharisees took that commandment to simply mean premeditated murder. The Hebrew word translated as kill in the Ten Commandments in Exodus, or as murder in a lot of modern translations, is talking about premeditated murder, murder for gain, murder for hire. It's talking about killing somebody out of hatred. It's not talking about a soldier defending his country in battle. It's not talking about a police officer shooting someone in the commission of a crime. It's not talking about you shooting someone trying to break into your home. It's premeditated murder. It's murder for gain. You're getting rid of a competition. You know, all the old gangster movies where mobsters are always shooting one another to gain control of the territory, to put their jukeboxes in or their serve only their beer or whatever. That's what this commandment is talking about. Taking a life for no reason, but then you're disliking it. So here Jesus is showing them, you haven't fulfilled this commandment because you haven't murdered anybody. When you have anger so much at somebody that you hate them, that's murder. And if you call them you fool, you can end up in hell. Now, to put your minds at rest, because probably everybody here has called somebody a fool at one time or another. The word translated for fool here is from a Hebrew word which literally meant for someone that had no spirituality or to have no regard for God. So in other words, when you called somebody in Jesus' day a fool, you were judging them and saying they had no regard for God, they had no spirituality, they had no faith, and that was not your judgment to make. Because we don't know what's in somebody's heart. That's what Jesus tells us about judging. When he says that we shouldn't judge others or we'll be judged like we'll judge them, he's not talking about a court of law. Upholding the laws of a community and sitting on a jury and making a judgment on a defendant. Or being a judge in a trial where you don't want a jury trial, you just want to appear before the judge and the judge makes a decision. He's not talking about, he's talking about judging people spiritually, their regard for God, their faith, saying whether or not they're Christian or non-Christian, saying whether or not they're going to heaven or hell. We do not have that judgment, that power to make that judgment or that right. So that's what he's talking about when he says you fool. So you see already that it's impossible. It's a demand we can't meet. This commandment of murder. And he goes on and shows how bad anger is, saying, you know, if you're going to go get the gift at the altar, and you remember you're mad at somebody, go and reconcile with it. And this is a very important point that Jesus is making, the importance to reconcile with one another. As brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, we are to reconcile with one another. That is part of the reason for the development of the sharing of the peace. Is that's an opportunity to seek out those who maybe you are aggravated with or whatever before you come forward for the Lord's Supper, and you share the peace and you're reconciling with one another and with God. So the law is demands we can't meet. You have heard that it was said, you will not commit adultery, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery. I doubt if there's anyone who is honest can say they never violated that part of the commandment. Whether a man looking at a woman or a woman looking at a man, and sometime in your life not having lust for them. But that's how it's demands we can't meet. And so the Pharisees were foolish in thinking that they could meet. So Jesus is showing that he is the perfect way. These words of Jesus confront the false assumptions made about God's law and show us what is correct. That it's not the mind over the heart, it's the heart over the mind. See, the Pharisees looked at everything literally, strictly by the letter. You should not murder, to them make the physical act. You are fulfilling the law. They would not stop to consider, what do you do when you're faced with a situation that by participating in the removal of someone, you will better the lives of millions of people. This is something we call situation ethics. If you remember back in the 80s, Jerry Falwell used to rail against situation ethics. So there's no situation ethics, they're just Christian ethics that you follow. Well, let me give you an example of situation ethics. Almost everyone here is familiar with Deacon Bonhoeffer, German Lutheran pastor and theologian. Eventually was executed for participating in a plot to assassinate Adolf Hitler. When Bonhoeffer was approached about being part of this plot by his brother, he wrestled with him. I am a pastor, I am a theologian. Can I kill? Can I sit there and take another person's life? And what made him finally agree to be part of the plot was a realization that by getting rid of Hitler, you would be saving millions of people who were involved in a horrible war. You would be saving millions of people sentenced to death, condemned to death in concentration camps. Not just the Jews, but gypsies and political opponents, theologians, pastors, priests, nuns, anyone who was considered a valuable producer to the German Reich. They were all exterminated. And so Bonhoeffer decided that it was justified for him to get rid of Hitler for the good of others. And what did Jesus say? What greater gift is this than you lay down your life for your friends? That's what Bonhoeffer was trying to do. But let me give you another example. Now, I can remember giving this to a Bible study group one time and how the division in opinions. But remember now, what Jesus is talking about is love over the mind. But the motivation of the law was not using your mind to fulfill it by strict interpretation of an action, but it was given to show love in the mind. Toward the end of World War II, a German commander was captured by the Russians. He was sent to a Russian prisoner of war camp that was set up right outside a German village, which happened to be where the German commander had lived. It soon became known to the Russian commander of the prisoner of war camp that the commander's wife lived in that village. And so he had her brought to him just to see who she was and what she was like. And she was a very beautiful woman. And the Russian commander told her that she had a choice. If she would have relations with him, he would spare her husband's life. If she wouldn't, then she would kill her husband. Now, the Pharisees would say, you should not commit adultery. That's it. That's the way it stands. You don't have relations with anybody else. So she should tell the commander, no. Situation ethics says, what is the best good? The woman loved her husband so much that she submitted to the Russian commandant's demand. Afterwards, she turned up pregnant. The war ended. Her husband was released from a prisoner of war camp. He came home to find his wife impregnated by this Russian commander. What was the husband justified in doing? Should he stay with his wife because she only did this to save his life? Or does he leave his wife because she's carrying the child of someone else? See, that's putting love before rules. What do you decide? See, all situations aren't black and white, as Jerry Falwell used to presented this in class when I was in seminary, the majority of the class went with the husband should stay with the wife because she saved his life. She laid down her life, her reputation. She risked being scorned by her village, raising a child that was not from her element, all to save the life of her husband. When I gave it to a Bible study class, they were split 50-50. Some said, yes, he should stay with her. Others said, no, he should leave. So this is what Jesus is talking about. Life is not simple. But the law was given not to be a strict God, but to be a loving God for living. And love is at the center. And Jesus expects us to love as he loved us. And as we see in his ministry, he loved even the most undesired. He loved the outcast. He loved those who violated the law, the letter of the law. And he still loves them and still forgave them. And so righteousness is beyond our ability to achieve. That's the answer number four. Righteousness is beyond our ability to achieve. Because we are going to stumble in one way or another. And especially if we do not guide our lives by the love of Christ instead of by human standards. George IV, King George IV of England, wanted to receive communion one day, and so he sent one of his subordinates, a messenger to the bishop of London, to come to the palace and give him communion. Well, the messenger donned in his responsibility, taking in some of the sights of the marketplace and daily life outside of the palace walls. And so when the bishop finally arrived, it was late and the king was furious. So the king berated the messenger and fired him on the spot and told him to leave. Then he turned to the bishop and he said, now we may commence. To which the bishop responded to the king, no, my lord, we cannot continue. As long as you have that anger towards your messenger for making a mistake, you are not prepared to receive the body and blood of our Lord. The king responded to the bishop by saying, Bishop, you're correct. He had the messenger brought back to him and asked for the messenger's forgiveness, restored him to his position. And after that, the bishop then gave King George IV communion. See, that is putting that love into practice. The king was justified in firing the messenger. The messenger messed up. He dawdled. He was supposed to run directly to the bishop ring so the king could have communion within a half hour or so that he sent the messenger out. The messenger made a mistake. The king's anger was so great, though, that his mind was not ready to receive the body and blood of our Lord until he was willing to reconcile with that messenger, which he did. The bishop withheld the sacrament. Jesus is saying, if you try to earn salvation through this outward, just strict interpretation of the law, it's a demand you cannot meet and you will never meet. But if you trust in me, I will give you what you can achieve. And what we can achieve is salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. The law condemns the best man, and grace saves the worst man. Law condemns the best person, grace saves the worst person. You don't have to mutilate yourself to enter the kingdom of heaven. Once again, Jesus is going overboard to make a point. What he is saying is, if you really want to go by the letter of the law, that's what you would have to do. Your eye caused you to sin, then you have to pluck it out. If your hand caused you to sin, you would have to chop it off. oil, stop trying, and rely on me. Rely on the love that God shows us through his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus took our place so that we might have his peace. Jesus took our sin so that we might have his salvation. Jesus took our place that we might have his peace. Jesus took our sin so that we might have his salvation. So instead of trying to meet the demand of the law outwardly and being motivated simply by our mind or motivated by wanting to receive the praise of others, we are to live our life motivated by love. By the love of Jesus Christ. A love so strong that he willingly went to the cross to suffer and die on our behalf. It is true that we cannot meet the demands of the law for salvation by our own efforts, but by faith in Jesus Christ, the demands of the law are already met through him and met for our sake so that we can have salvation by grace through faith. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing Whiter Than Snow, which is on the back cover of your bulletin. Whiter Than Snow.
This hymn was written by James Nicholson, who was an Irish immigrant. He worked for the post office in Washington, D.C., wrote many hymns. James Nicholson wrote this hymn in 1872. He immigrated to the United States from Ireland. He was born in Ireland in the 1820s. The music was written by a German composer, William Fischer, F-I-S-C-H-E-R, a German composer who was a piano teacher, also a bookbinder. It's written by immigrants, German and Irish immigrants, this Whiter Than Snow. And it shows that where our sins are forgiven, whiter than snow, Jesus takes our sins upon himself, and we are not to live by the law but by faith. We obey the law but only through Jesus dying for us.
Thank you.
And so you please turn to page 105 in the front of your worship book to the words of the Apostles' Creed. And again, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as with the whole church and confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray that the light of Christ may shine upon the church, the world, and all people according to their need. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Most Holy Father, build the church into a holy temple filled with your Spirit, with Christ as a cornerstone. Give it faithful leaders who, like the apostles and martyrs, plant and water the seed of faith to which you alone give birth. Grant that in word and deed it sets before the world the way of life, and grant that many should choose it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Cause quarrels, angry words, and hurt feelings to cease in this congregation. Unite us in a common purpose, planting and tending the seed of faith in one another, in our children and grandchildren, and in our friends, neighbors, and community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our sisters and brothers in the faith who experience danger, persecution, and even death on account of Jesus. When we are tempted to ignore your commandments, set before us your example of faithful obedience to your word. Grant that their witness may bring a rich harvest of repentance and faith among those who tormented them. Conform our sister congregations and descendants to your holy will, and speed your gospel to many hearts and many lands through the works and words of your missionaries. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Protect and direct those who serve in the military and first responders. Help them to do what is right, even though the task is dangerous and difficult. Use their courage and skill to establish safety and order in chaotic situations, and return them safely to their loved ones when their task is done. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift before you the needs of everyone who is afflicted by suffering, sin, or sorrow. Deliver them from evil, grant them refreshment, hope, and healing, and restore them to fellowship with all who love them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Father, keep in your tender care all who have died and trusted in your promises, especially those whose loss we grieve most deeply. Give us grace to comfort one another, to abound in gentleness, forbearance, self-control, faithfulness, and compassion, and to constantly choose those good things which you mean for our eternal life. And grant us the joy of joining the choir of angels and the whole company of the redeemed in praising, worshiping, glorifying, and adoring you forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, merciful Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
Now time for our offering. Mary and Bill Nevius are our ushers. Thank you for watching us on YouTube. We are happy to have you with us. Now that our acolytes are bringing the offering plates forward, and Mary and Bill Nevius are coming forward as ushers to receive the gifts that we give to God today in our offering. We offer ourselves, we offer our time, we offer our lives, we offer our belief. We give these to Jesus Christ, who died on the cross to save us from sin. As Jesus received our sins, washed us clean, whiter than snow, this is February the 12th, 2017, the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. The Epiphany is the time when the three kings came to worship Jesus Christ. They were Gentiles, just as we are Gentiles, accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, took Him into their heart, worshiped Him just as we are offered. We're able to do this, and after we die, we receive Jesus, and we can see His face, we see the face of God, we're with Him forever and ever. We know that God is a spirit, and we will dwell with Him in heaven. Today is the worship of the service of the Word. Next week is the sacrament of Holy Communion. We receive Jesus Christ's body and blood to be with us forever. Today we're worshiping God through the Word, through His Word. Lived from 1674 to 1748. He's known as the father of English hymnology. Wrote a hymn a week starting about age 18. Brilliant, precocious man, Isaac Watts. Oh, that the Lord might guide my ways. Englishman, Anglican clergyman. February at 9:30. Their Sunday school is at 8:30. during March. We'll go back to the 8 o'clock service and the 10:30 service. We also have services on Wednesday night. We receive Holy Communion in the chapel, and that's on every Wednesday night. We thank you for attending with us. We thank you for worshiping us virtually. And we thank you for thanking the people who gave the flowers today. We have 4 vases of flowers. One is in honor of Bill Shively's birthday. Bill Shively is 106 years old. Lutherans have a way of living. To be old, we try to follow God's laws, try to keep ourselves clean, and we respect the body, the temple of the soul. We're happy to have had Bill Shively with us all these 106 years. He's been a devout Christian, born and raised here in Springfield, baptized. 106 years old, still very clear mentally, very good sense of humor. The flowers are also from Linda Anderson in memory of Terry Anderson's birthday. And the flowers are given by Cindy Pearson and family in honor of Les Pearson and Mandy Pearson for their birthdays, 2 birthdays. In memory of Bill DeSello's birthday, 3 birthdays, many birthdays. Bill Shively, 106, Terry Anderson's birthday in memory of him, died recently. Also the birthdays of Les Pearson, Mandy Pearson, and Bill DeSello. We have 3 beautiful vases of flowers, yellow and white flowers. They're given in honor of those people's birthdays. We thank you for worshiping with us today. Our theme today was, we have the law, but we are unable to obey the law without Jesus to be with us. We cannot by ourselves forgive our own sins. Jesus died for us. God forgives us our sins. He throws them away as far as the east and the west. He puts them in the ocean, and we no longer have to be concerned. We're washed whiter than snow. And God, the Lord guides our ways, as Isaac Watts wrote in his famous hymn, "Oh, that the Lord would guide my ways." We also sang the hymn today, "Whiter than Snow," washed whiter than snow, written by a post office worker, an immigrant, an Irish immigrant, and the music is written by a German immigrant. Combination of German and Irish words and music. We can enjoy this beautiful hymn today, "Whiter than Snow." We invite you to come during February, 9:30 service, 8:30 Sunday school, and the rest of the year, 8 o'clock service, 9:15 Sunday school, and 10:30 service. Come worship with us anytime. We invite you to repent, believe, love God, love one another, invite Jesus into your heart, and he will be ruler of your life. You will be happy. This is the way to have happiness.